Hey guys, welcome to round two. We are facing one Poodle Star Generica. Pretty intricate name. Oh god, this hand's so close. This hand's so close. If these were islands, I would snap keep off the strength of Mana Vault into Consecrated Sphinx, and I wouldn't really care about the rest of the hand. Or if one of these fine blue cards was in fact a Primeval Titan, then this hand would be great. We are on the play though, so not much to be done about it. This hand's okay. Needs a little help, but we're gonna get a scry, we're gonna get a cantrip off the remand. Maybe get a little bit of time off of strip mining. A hapless opponent. We're gonna lead off with island, and that way if we draw Mox, we can play Mox and hold up remand as we strip mine our opponent. We're just gonna strip the first land that we see. Do we keep this? It's rough, right? It's rough. Because it's like so far away from now. I'm actually gonna bottom this one. I think we've got enough juice. I think we've got enough action in the deck that we don't need to keep a six drop and when our hand isn't quite there. Oh, what an awfully strip mineable land. What a nice watery grave. Be a shame if something happened to it. Alright. Got some forests here. Oh, that's better. That's a little better. Got the old single black source in the deck to play this Silumgar eventually. I can get behind that. And we know that our opponent doesn't have actual factual counterspell. They might have Mana Drain, which is better, I suppose, but all right, Mr. Poodle Star Generica, if that is your real name, let's see what you got going on. Badlands facing Grixis, huh? Mesmeric Fiend. Yeah, I'll cycle a remand. Not doing anything else with it. I think I like Eternal Witnessing Vax Strip Mine. I think I like that better than running out the true name here. Like, the true name might just win the game, but I mean, this might just win the game too, right? And if he Mesmeric Fiends the true name Nemesis, then he's not taking the Silumgar. And right now we have the lands to actually cast the Silumgar. We hit a second dual land, right? We hit two black producing dual lands out. Ah, okay, he got there anyway. What a fiend. Now our opponent has to plan. Yeah, don't blame him for taking the true name. Don't blame him at all. I don't think we're gonna get up to library. Maybe if we ripped Harmonize. Just doesn't seem likely. Oh, he had plenty of mana drops. Ah, we should have played the true name. Well, we still have a body to equip things to if we draw a sword or whatever. And if he doesn't do anything particularly interesting, then the Lumbering Falls can serve. Interesting that the Mesmeric Fiend didn't attack. Could imply that he intends to trade off, but I don't really see the benefit. This could get ugly. Maybe he has Diabolic Edict for the Lumbering Falls now. Or perhaps he has a way to make me discard my hand. Like, you make that kind of a block before you're about to play a Wheel of Fortune, you know? Where they discard their hand anyway. I just want to smack him with the Lumbering Falls, as opposed to like playing the True Name Nemesis into counter magic. Like, if he couldn't answer it last turn, then... Uh-oh. Take your time. All right. Kind of a scary card to have resolve. Okay. So you untap Grixis Colors after resolving Dig Through Time with about half your starting life total. You know that your opponent's hand is Dragonlord Silumgar, True Name Nemesis, and some lands. Perfect information, all the cards in the world. Bet you're feeling pretty good. Dev's Disc. Okay. Well, that's a reason to not be particularly afraid about True Name Nemesis. I almost maybe shouldn't have even played the True Name. Like, just don't play anything. Like, just sit here, start building up cards in my hand so I can start drawing something to catch up to him. Like, I could have just smacked him again with the Lumbering Falls. Planeswalkers and Nev's Disc work pretty well together. So, our opponent almost certainly has another counterspell, right? Which is gonna just get us. But the idea behind the Silumgar is to make him crack the Nev's Disc so that we can go Avenger plus Land Drop. And then, if for some reason he was out of, like, counters and removal and stuff, then the Avenger could potentially stabilize. He does get to downtick Chandra to clear the tokens, but then we have a 5-5 and a 3-3 to pressure the Chandra at least. Not the worst plan ever. Not the best plan ever either, but not the worst plan ever. Opponent's down to 5 cards in hand. To smack me down to 8. Yeah, Chandra's so good. I want to play that card in Modern. I think that card's good enough for Modern. Just need to be able to play it in time, right? Like, 6 mana is so much for Modern. It's so much, but it's such a good card. Such a good Planeswalker. If Seething Song was still in Modern, I could get away with playing Chandra. Yeah, he's got a removal spell. Well, that's a real bummer. Looks like a Hero's Downfall from the mana that he's got. Yep. The Avenger of Zendikar would pump the Wall of Blossoms too, because it's a plant. Ugh, we already churned through our Eternal Witness. So how are we going to win this game? Are we going to win this game? Can we win this game? We got some blockers for 3-1s. Almost to the point where he wants to downtick Chandra for a turn to get in damage. Oh, he's got something else. Gilded Lotus? Yeah, I'm fine with that. Gilded Lotus into something, I'm less fine with that. 5 mana, this is a Time Warp. Time Warp would be pretty game-winning. I'd probably concede to a Time Warp here. Zealous Conscripts. Well, that doesn't do anything. Untap my Gilded Lotus, okay. You have 1 Gilded Lotus untapped. Now what? Hit me down to 5. Not the end of the world. If the Gilded Lotus represents a counterspell, then this was a pretty good turn. Propes himself down to 9. I believe the plan is to activate Lumbering Falls, suited up, and serve at the Chandra, and then we'll have 2 counters to clear through the Chandra uptick, so we'll live through another turn. Do we attack the Chandra, or do we attack him? I think we actually attack him. Like, it's a matter of dealing the Chandra 5 or him 7, you know? He did an Imperial Seal there, so it's a high likelihood he just has something now. Splinter Twin for the Zealous Conscripts, maybe? It's kind of amusing to Imperial Seal for like a combo piece to deal infinite when your opponent's sitting there at 5 life. But yeah, that's going to be pretty good. Okay, so we got to see what our opponent's deck was about. Once again, I think we're going to be boarding in Tarmogoyf. I like the swords against him. I don't like Wall of Blossoms. Wall of Roots is still okay. I almost want the Sword of Light and Shadow as well. I think I'm gonna bring in the Revoker, even though it's not that groovy. Is there a way we could have played that game better? It's hard to say. Oh, I guess we could have played the True Name Nemesis instead of the Eternal Witness back Strip Mine. I thought the Eternal Witness back Strip Mine was pretty defensible though, especially because we were. Like, he had fetched for Badlands, right? And so he had Island, Badlands. I think Eternal Witness Strip Mine there is defensible for sure. And then, like, if he Mesmeric Fiends... We also didn't... Like, with the turn that he traded off Mesmeric Fiend, it's, like, kind of a... Kind of an indicator that he's either going to attack our hand or play a sweeper of some sort, in which case the Mesmeric Fiend is a liability, and then it turned out to be the Nev's Disc. So we didn't figure it out at the time, but that was the card to be afraid of. So we need to shave two cards here, because we're bringing in some things. This one might not actually be very good. Same with this one, actually. Okay. Yeah, I can get behind this. We're gonna go turn one, Lumbering Falls. And then turn two, we're gonna fire off a Courser. And then hopefully start to get some value there. Yeah, dude, Bonder away. Fish Bonder. Fishy fish. Oh, we see the same sky as you, just through a different lens. Okay. Okay, we could True Name on turn two. Just like turn two True Name Nemesis. Is that better? Is that better than turn two Courser? He showed us Hero's Downfall. Yeah, let's actually go for True Name. I wish this Mox Pearl was on color, because then we could do Strip Mine Shenanigans next turn. But yeah, it's kind of early. Kind of an early True Name. And the Lumbering Falls is going to be activating fairly soon. Top, sure. Top away, mate. Top away. Do we Wall of Roots? I think we can. Someone commented in one of my videos once that I was, after watching many, many cubes drafted on Channel Fireball, that he thinks that I was the only person to ever play a Tarmogoyf. Sometimes you just need a vanilla body, man. Sometimes you just need some valueless meat stick, some 2-mana 1/2 to carry your deck full of equipment. It doesn't look very good right now, but it should grow fairly large in this matchup. We've got to... enchantments and artifacts and all kinds of things going to the graveyard. So this next turn I am going to strip mine him to keep him off of ooh, we got a dragon on top. I can get behind that. Yeah, I want to strip mine him to keep him off of Nev's Disc. And by getting the blue source, we're also keeping him off of Mana Drain for a bit. I'm gonna set a stop in my begin combat. I wanna like drain his mana pool before we activate Lumbering Falls. I don't think it'll matter, but no reason not to. Oh, he's just spinning top. Sure, whatever. This is terminate mana. If he's going to terminate the Courser, then I think he would do it earlier, right? Oh, I have to do this first. Yeah, we could have, like, Eternal Witnessed back Strip Mine and run out of Tarmogoyf. But attacking for 7 seems pretty good, right? I think it's pretty good. Okay, and he does have a Doomblade type effect. Oh, I guess it was attacking for 8, right? Because these are both 3Xs. Still keeping our opponent off of Nev's disc mana. Yeah, our opener this game was great as far as applying pressure goes. I don't think our hand last game was bad in the dark, but it was just kind of bad for the matchup. Yeah, two mana five six. Got more Doom Blades. Can I clear my Tarmogoyf? Does that still have him on dead next turn? Yeah, he can kill the Tarmogoyf and we're still representing lethal. Exaxes. To be Pacific Fire. Okay. Just clearing the Eternal Witness, I guess. I wonder why he didn't do a point to me. Hey, we won one. All right. Now we're going to be on the draw, which is going to make Strip Mine a wee bit worse, which is unfortunate. But there's not much I can do about it. Do I like Feast and Famine better than Light and Shadow? I like both of them quite a deal. Quite a bit. Yeah, I think I prefer it this way. Well, this looks like exactly the sort of hand that's going to lose this matchup without doing anything relevant at all. If we had, like, our mana rock, you know, if we had the one mana produce three, we'd keep this off the back of the Consecrated Sphinx, but we don't, so we're not. Even if I had, like, a secure Tribe Elder or something, then I'd probably keep this, because, like, the difference between, like, a turn three opposition or harmonize against, like, a turn four one is pretty big. This is kind of better. Still kind of slow. I think we have to bottom that. So we don't even have our second blue for the Mystic Snake. Running out Forest instead of Island here, because if I draw Mox Pearl for my next rip, I want to be able to fire off the Courser of Crucifix. Yeah, dude, Fiend Away. Fiend Away. My hand's not very good. I'm sure he's happy to see this. Just like a pile of green nonsense that doesn't really do anything. The Whisperwood Elemental could be good against a Nev's Disc. Oh, he took the Mystic Snake. That's not a good sign for me. That's right. That's like an actively bad sign for me, because the Mystic Snake was the card in our hand that, like, we can't really cast. So if he thinks that's the scariest one, that means he cares, like, not even a little bit about these other cards. Scepter, what's going on under Scepter? Some ultimate price shenanigans. Yeah, that hits. Destroy target monocolored creature. I guess that explains him taking the one gold creature in my hand, right? The one thing he can't ultimate price. Yeah. This is going to be a hard game to win. I think it's going to involve... I don't even know what it could involve. Opponent's down to three cards in hand. I guess we have a Silumgar in here somewhere. Yeah, we can't even really flood the board. Maybe if we stuck a Prime Time. This looks like a Chandra, though. Okay. So we're a man away from going Whisperwood plus equip, which is unfortunate, because Whisperwood would be the best card to stick. So we're going to play the Courser first, just in case it gives us some value off the top of our library before we make our land drop. There's a Preordain. Preordain's not bad here. Preordain's not bad at all. So I'd have to imagine that he has some kind of an answer to a Courser with the Sword of Feast and Famine on it, because he knew that we had the Courser in hand, and the Sword of Feast and Famine was on board. So tapping out for Chandra is risky if he has nothing. Especially because the Mesmeric Fiend can't even chump. Inquisition, sure. Inquisition it up. Probably take the Eternal Witness. Opponent agrees. Down to two cards. With the untap off of Sword of Feast and Famine, we could almost get a Flood on. Like, play some things pre-combat, smack him, make him... But the Abyss is targeted, so it's not going to be able to kill a creature that has a Sword of Feast and Famine on it. Yeah, so on board, this just kills his Mesmeric Fiend. Interesting. He probably thought this was going to kill the Courser, because otherwise his line doesn't make any sense. What's the Abyss? That player controls of his or her choice. Speaking of cards that live through the Abyss, that's a true name nemesis. Oh man, that Lumbering Falls is like so close to what we want, but not really. Oh, we can untap it. We can untap it with the Sword of Feast and Famine hit. Oh, that's glorious. That's glorious. Well, I guess we would have untapped the island anyway. Still a good one to get into play. Okay, so Whisperwood. Oh, if we don't hit the Chandra. Yeah, if we don't hit the Chandra, then we're gonna be in an awkward spot. Damn. Because the Chandra can neg 6 to clear the Courser, so we kind of have to attack it. Oh well, so we're not going to get that sort of Feast and Famine hit after all. Although, if we smacked him with the Courser, he discards his last card, we untap. Then I go True Name Nemesis. And we're going to get a trigger, and we can play the Tarmogoyf. And if he tries to neg 6 Chandra, we sack the Whisperwood Elemental. And the True Name's going to live through everything. Alright, I kind of like getting his last card. And how large is Tarmogoyf right now? It's a 3-4. Oh, his last card was a Nev's Disc. Interesting, interesting. Well, pretty glad we got that out of his hand. I'm gonna play the Tarmogoyf or not. I think we do. Now the real question is whether we think he's going to downtick that Chandra or not. In which case, I'd rather have the Sword of Feast and Famine on Goyf. Yeah, let's move it. Well, I was wondering how we were going to win this game, and then our opponent tapped out for Chandra, and then abyssed his own creature, and let us make him discard the Nev's Disc, which would have reset the board nicely. So I think we're still in this. Yeah, I think we're still in this. And by in this, I mean winning. I mean, I feel like we're decidedly winning this game, unless he's got something real interesting in his hand right now, because once we untap, we're going to have Mystic Snake going. Down to X equals 4. All right. He can respond to that by killing the Courser, which I recommend. Let's resolve. Goyf's a 7/8. Jeez. Oh, it takes 3 to flip it up. I can pay 3. We could have chosen to draw there too. Yeah, we still have a Silumgar in the deck. We can get a swamp and an island. We could have chosen to pay the 2 life to draw, or the 2 mana to draw as well, because we're probably smacking him with the sword on the Tarmogoyf. But then we're not attacking with the Lumbering Falls. Do we want to attack with Lumbering Falls? I actually think so. I think if he had an answer to our nonsense, he would have played it as a sorcery instead of letting me untap with a Mystic Snake. So I think the Lumbering Falls is a free hit. Maybe greedy. And that should be that. Yeah, I think this game would have been real hard if he'd just been a little bit more patient with his Chandra. I think our opponent didn't quite realize how the Abyss interacted with like Sword of Feast and Famine. The fact that the Abyss is a targeted thing, like it doesn't make someone sacrifice a creature every turn. It targets. So a card like Mother of Runes is really good against the Abyss. Or cards like Nimble Mongoose. It's one of the reasons that the Abyss hasn't seen a ton of Legacy plays, because like Nimble Mongoose and True Name Nemesis are cards. It's also kind of expensive for Legacy, like 4 mana is a lot to not clear the board. But yeah, maybe just inexperience on their part. Who knows? Who knows what was going on? But we're into the finals. I did like the opponent's deck, like lots of good cards. Chandra is obviously amazing, and he got a ultimate price down under a Scepter, and that was very scary.